My name is Marie Hebert from the Sumitro Chair for Southeast Asian Studies here at CSIS. It's a delight to see all of you. We're obviously very delighted to have a senior official coming from the new President Jokowi's administration in Indonesia. I'd like to just notice, I guess we don't have it on the board, but if people want to follow this event on Twitter, you can go at Southeast Asia DC or at CSIS or hashtag CSIS Live. I think at least some of the of our staff here are going to be tweeting during the Pak Luhut's speech. I'd also like to just announce that this Banyan Tree Leadership Forum is sponsored under a new renewed program that we've just been re-established, and that is that we will renew our Derwin Pereira Indonesia Initiative. This is a speaker series that we have on Indonesia here at CSIS. It's a platform for discussing politics, economics, private sector engagement, environmental issues, education, etc. So we thank Derwin Pereira very much for his support. Our speaker today, as you've seen from our invitation, is a senior advisor to President Jokowi. His name is Pak Luhut Panjaitan, who is, as I said, a senior advisor, who's named in October. Previously, he's had a host of very prominent positions in Indonesia. He was most recently ambassador to Singapore. He previously served as Minister of Industry and Trade. He is the founder of an energy and mining company called Toba Sejahtra Group. And in his earlier career, he was also an officer in the Indonesian Army from 1970 to 2000, and he reached the rank of general. He has some roots in Washington. He graduated with a master's in public administration from George Washington University. General Luhut, it's a great pleasure to have you here. Do you want to stand here? Do you want? I'd like to also just apologize for the awkward formation of this room. There's so much that goes on at CSIS, and sometimes we have to squeeze into spaces we hadn't planned to squeeze into. So that's why we have this formation today. Sorry about that, but I think we'll make up for it with the content of the discussion. Thank you, General. Please.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. It's a great honor for me to be here this afternoon. It's such a very prestigious institution. And I was introduced by Murray, about myself. Yes, but I spent quite some time also in U.S. Army Special Forces training. I was in Fort Bragg two times back to 1978 when I was captain, and enjoy very much Fort Bragg, and also I went to several training with the U.S. Army Special Forces, and also we established kind of a joint exercise with the U.S. Army Special Forces in Indonesia years ago when I was major Lieutenant Colonel, but then started 2001, no more joint exercise with U.S. Army Special Forces until maybe some times ago. I hope that this joint exercise can be, pursued in the years to come, because I think the role of Indonesian Special Forces in Indonesia is very important, and also facing especially the ISIS threat right now. I think the common threat for Indonesia and U.S. Ladies and gentlemen, let me begin with the title of this presentation, The Key Challenge for Jokowi's Administration 2014 and 2019. Now, there are three immediate problems facing by President Jokowi is today. Number one, political configuration in the parliament. Number two, we are talking about the national security and foreign policy issue. And number three is domestic economic issues. And let me begin with the political configuration in the parliament. Before the presidential inauguration, if you look at now, the great Indonesian coalition supporting President Jokowi is 37%, consists of four political parties, while the opposition consists of five political parties, while the Democratic Party led by former President Jokowi as a balanced political party. Now, it's considered as opposition, the red and white coalition. And then after the inauguration, you see the configuration like this, next slide. See the Great Indonesian Coalition become 44%, and then the opposition political party 45%. A lot of foreigner, watching Indonesia very carefully because they understand the problem in the parliament is going to be very difficult for President Jokowi. And like in the U.S. also, the Congress now controlled by the Republican, of course, give also hard time for President Obama for the next 2 years' time. But Indonesia, I think, Pak Jokowi quite successful, I should say, quote unquote, to manage this issue. If you look at now today, this is the configuration. But if you look at per today, for yesterday, Monday and Tuesday, yesterday, Monday and Tuesday, today, another changing happening. And then P3, the Islamic political party, already shift to the great Indonesian coalition, while the Golkar is the largest political party within the red and white coalition, split with two leadership right now. One led by Mr. Abu Zira Bakri, and the one by Mr. Agung Laksono. So, quite easy, if I may say so, for Pak Jokowi now to manage because, no more solid coalition within the red and white coalition. But not only that, I think, because Pak Jokowi give a very, very good example, and his background is very clean, considered as very clean, at least until today. Hopefully, onward also still like this. But some of the leaders within the red and white coalition, they have quite a lot of problem behind, which is, I think, also this is the weakness point of them. If you look at today, Attorney General arrested like 87 of people in Indonesia linked to the corruption, some of them member of this political party. So give a strong signal to the, to the people of Indonesia that President Jokowi serious to tackle corruption issue within the country. Not only the anti-corruption agency now working on this particular area, also the Attorney General. Used to be Attorney General is a very weak position, but today he going to prove. He proved it that, okay, I can use also the hand of Attorney General to minimize corruption within the country. By doing so, this is also the strong signal to the political leader, okay, you better be careful. If you criticize the government very hard, then you are also facing to the other problem because the government very transparent to lead this country. Next slide. Now, let me remind you also the presidential system in Indonesia, I think it's similar to US, a check and balance system. I think it's very important for Indonesia because we learn also from US and to secure also the administration program, government needs to cooperate with the parliament. But parliament also role is very important for Indonesia, but in the same time, also the government also, especially for the budget issue, that also can use the previous year budget for this year budget if the government, if the parliament, disapprove the budget proposed by the government. Yeah, next. Now, if you look at now the last, I just give you one example, the mood of the Indonesian people. Look at to the survey result by Bill Lindell, that 54% people of Indonesia like to see the honesty, like to see the leader with honor, with honest, that he can tell the truth, because they'll maybe get tired with some talking about good thing, while in reality, they play behind. So that's, I think, the strong point of Pak Jokowi. He's very sincere, very humble, very honest, and he proved it. He showed it to the people of Indonesia today. Look at, for instance, it's very funny sometimes, if you look at now, he, you know, still using economic class flying, you know, within the country. It's sometimes very hard for us to understand, you know. Sometimes make like chaotic or in the airplane, you know, everybody wants selfie with the president, you know. Yeah, and you cannot see it in the U.S., so many secret services around you. This is one of the problem, but he proved it that he can manage. And also the delegation of Jokowi right now, number of delegation is very, he reduced significantly. Used to be maybe 100 people, now only 17. Like in the Beijing conference, for instance, the APEC meeting. His delegation only 31 people. But this is also, we have to be careful, you know, look at, because his number of secret service only 9 people, which is, I think, very hard for them to protect the president for the 9 days trip, you know. So it's kind of adjustment needed in the next time. Yeah, next slide. Now, also, if you look at now the Jokowi leadership, as I mentioned earlier about example as a role model, look at the expenditure of the, you know, the government. They like to squeeze, especially to the unnecessary expenses, traveling expenses, yeah, for the, you know, government official. He make it more and more efficient. I think the expenses for, you know, unnecessary things, also like meeting outside of the office while they can do it within the office, but they do it in the hotel, now no more. Move it to the office of the government. If you look at now, I'll give you an example. The budget for the only meeting in Indonesia, like 41 trillion rupiah. Yeah, now they cut it maybe like to 24 trillion rupiah. So nearly half, 41 trillion rupiah, so like nearly $4 billion. Now less than that, only maybe less than $2 billion. So give significant number that people enjoy it very much. Wow, the president give the example. His minister give a good example. His government official give a good example. But in the same time also create some problem, you know, because the salary system in Indonesia is, you know, still very low, you know. We have to restructuring, like a president's salary, for instance, $3,000, while the CEO of Pertamina, the national oil company, maybe $21,000 or $22,000, so unfair. And also the OJK, and also the central bank, the president of central bank is like $40,000. So we have to, you know, restructure this. Have to see the, you know, the structure of the salary fixed in the years to come, especially for the bureaucrat in the, like in the embassy, our embassy. I mean, the member of our embassy salary, maybe we have to improve also. We have to see the for them to, you know, to survive, to enough money for them to serve their live in foreign countries. Yeah, next. Now, national security issue, the number two, let me start with this. If you see that there are three issues. Number one, radicalism becomes a serious issue, and two, poverty and low level of education. The radicalism, I think, is one issue like ISIS, like ISIS and Al-Qaeda to some extent. This is one issue that we have to address very well. And poverty, that's why the program of Pak Jokowi, we are not only talking about the economic growth, but we are also talking at the same time about equality. Equality is very important. And number three, also talking about the low level of education. Education is very important because you understand that the demographic bonus of Indonesia is very good. It's like for the next 15 years, it's very beautiful, but at the same time, we are facing the problem about the quality of education, especially on technology. On technology side, I think outside of Jawa, very little university focus on technology. So we have to improve this. President Jokowi understand very much. If we are not successful to tackle this demographic bonus, then become a threat in the future. So then we have to improve the quality of education. We have to have the good universities around Indonesia. That's why, like president of Freeport, for instance, we discussed it last time, you have to build a good university in that your area to support that area. to give them incentive to improve. You know, it's like a free port. It's very easy for them to invest for education in that particular area, not only to give money to the local leaders of the tribes, but also to provide kind of education over there to be involved in this education area, because this is very important for the people of Indonesia. Yeah. Now, talking about the illegal economy in Indonesia, if you look at now this slide, for instance, that our marine sector, for instance, that we have to handle this one very much. Like, I give you one example of illegal fishing. Yeah. Illegal fishing, there's a slide show you the numbers. We can save like $23 billion per annum if you're successful to tackle the illegal fishing. That's why the government policy today is very hard, very tough. We are not allowed anymore the illegal fishing operate in within the Indonesian territory. We're going to take the very hard action of this, because so far we keep talking, arrest them, and promise to bring to the court, and nothing happened. Play again something over there. Now the president say no, execute. Once you take it out, execute in place. So make it very quick. Now you see the fish price in outside of Indonesia become higher, while in Indonesian fish price in within the country lower. So they give a good example. So this kind of policy basically give proof to the people of Indonesia that President Joko is serious to handle this kind of problem. Yeah. Now, let me move to the defense budget. I mentioned early that we have to manage to control our sea territory. Yeah, Indonesia considered as one of the largest archipelago country. Now, if you look at the budget of our armed forces, like 0.8% of our GDP. Our GDP right now is $1 trillion, so consider it's like $7.2 billion. But if you compare it to Singapore and Malaysia, we are much lower. So what's the government policy? We're going to increase this defense budget up to 1.5% for the next 5 years, but we link to the economic growth. Our economic growth above 7%, I think we can even go higher. So maybe by 2019, the national budget, defense budget maybe can go to around $20 billion per annum. Yeah. By doing so, then we can enhance or strengthen the performance of our armed forces, and we can manage or protect our own sovereignty, and we can handle illegal fishing. Like I mentioned earlier, that we can save like $20 billion or maybe $23 billion U.S. dollar per annum. So this is, I think, very important. Not only talking because we like to see our armed forces very strong, but we also to manage or to protect our own economic interest. This is also important to build up our cooperation, especially facing the ISIS threat. I think this is common threat. This is one issue that discussed by President-elect Jokowi at the time with Senator John McCain. And I think we Indonesia commit to deal with this, ISIS, and we are very confident that we can tackle this one. Although we understand around 300 Indonesian fighters somewhere now with the ISIS, but we have already some policy on this, and we are very comfortable that we can do it together, that we can manage this one. But the very important re-establish Special Forces Cooperation, U.S. Army Special Forces Cooperation, Indonesian Special Forces, I think it's very important. Why? Simple. Like in the U.S. system, I think your CIA using your own Delta or your SEAL team to deal with this kind of problem on behalf of, supply by the CIA intelligence. Same thing in Indonesia. I think our intelligence agency using also our special forces to deal with this. So now, if you don't have a good relation between the U.S. Army Special Forces and the Indonesian Army Special Forces, then maybe the to handle this kind of threat is not going to be very effective. Yeah. Now, strong armed forces and foreign policy. I think very important also the role of our armed forces over there could balance the, you know, the situation in the, in this region. If you look at now the China armed forces is much stronger, you look at now India and look at Indonesia. So Indonesia can play a role to, you know, to balance the power, balance of power in, this region. If you look at now the in, South China Sea, one of the issues that are very important for U.S. and Indonesia as well, and Pak Jokowi policy is very clear, like to see a dialogue as a, to promote dialogue to solve this problem. And at the same time, we have to secure also CPAT in that particular area so then economic and not disturbed by this dispute. And in recent leadership within the ASEAN, I think is very important, being the largest ASEAN countries. As you are aware, I think the population of ASEAN is around 600, while Indonesian population 250, so nearly half of the ASEAN population in Indonesia. While in our economy right now quite good, 6% something growth, and I believe after, you know, 1.5 years, then we can go above 6%. I strongly believe in that because after the high fuel price, then our current account deficit also become a very much better, and again, the, nearly no resistance at all from the domestic people. So, yeah, this is very good signal for Indonesia that the policy taken by the President Jokowi is accepted by the people of Indonesia. Yeah, next. Now, if you look at now the Indonesian maritime, this is, I think, very important issue that also one of the President Jokowi program. Maritime issue is very important because the location, strategic location of Indonesia, in that look at the slide, this is very important. So we like to play our role more effective and in this area, so then Indonesia could, you know, improve some of our facilities in order also to give, to reduce the cost of our transportation within the country. So this is, I think, very important in this region. Yeah. Now let me move to the domestic economy issue. There are two issues that I'm going to present in this one. The reallocation of energy subsidies, and number two, improve infrastructure quality. This, I think, those two issues is very important for the Indonesia in the next 5 years. Yeah. Now, if you look at now reallocation of energy subsidy, yeah, subsidy, I think around $31 billion per annum, which is, I think, huge. We have to tackle this one, reduce this one, and then we'll bring this, reallocate the subsidy to the infrastructure, health and education. If you look at on the right slide, on the right slide on the box, you see the subsidy for the fuel and for the gasoline is around 120 trillion rupiah. But in the same time, the red block, you see the reduced price of crude oil today. So, per today, I believe around $65, which is, I think, good for Indonesia because the cost of transportation, the cost of so many things in Indonesia can be reduced today. So by hike the fuel price last month, then we can save like $11 billion next year. So then we can reallocate this budget for infrastructures. So then the year after, maybe we can go up to $15 or $20 billion. So by doing so, then our national budget today is $200 billion. I believe for the next 3-4 years, maybe we can go up double, maybe nearly $400 billion per year. Now, if you look at now, how much money do we need, budget do we need for the next 5 years for infrastructure? If you look at the slide, I think we need $545 billion. And, you know, there are so many things that we can do together over there. They like also the presence of U.S. in Indonesia. And I understand right now the American economy much better than 3 years ago. When we were here 2 years ago, in U.S. economy is like this, but today, if you look at much better than before, much better than Europe. You look at Europe now, I was in Paris 2 weeks ago. I think unemployment rate over there, unbelievable, 9.5%. Look at now in the US, I think below 6%. Yeah, so compared to when, like 2 years ago, like 8-something%. So you see the difference. So now the Europe economy also not so good. Japan also nearly recession, and Russia right now nearly, you know, recession as well, because the economy, the crude oil reduced significantly, so revenue there also less. And the same time also Brazilian already in recession, and US moving up like this. In Asia, you look at now China, I think also their economy is still around 7.5%, and India, yeah, still very good, above 6%, Indonesia 5.3%. So those three countries, I think, in this area, play a very big, a very significant role. Now, so the president of US, Indonesia, I think is very, very for Indonesia, very important for Indonesia, especially for the next 5 years. Now, ladies and gentlemen, because I come to my conclusion, the other issue that addressed by Pak Jokowi is, President Jokowi, is transportation cost. Transportation cost in Indonesia is very high. The previous slide, if you look at now, it is 14.1% compared to Japan, only 4.9%. What we're going to do, we like to reduce this this cost to 7.5% for the next 5 years. By doing so, then I think the Indonesia more competitive for the years to come. So we are working very hard to do this. This is why very important the toll, sea toll program of Pak Jokowi to, you know, to reduce transportation costs within the country. If you look at today, for instance, the cost to transport goods from Java to Papua, much more expensive compared from Java to Hokkaido, Japan. So we have to reduce this one. So to make Indonesia more attractive for the investor. So many islands of Indonesia, like in Sumatra, like in Kalimantan and Sulawesi. So there are so many things that can be done in Indonesia. So I'd like to see also more investors from US to come to Indonesia. Ladies and gentlemen, let's come to my conclusion of this presentation. I think the beauty of Pak Jokowi, a strong leadership. He gave a good example to the people of Indonesia, which is, I think, very important. Like I mentioned earlier, Indonesia is a paternalistic system. I think the people follow the leader. When the leader give a good example, they will follow. And number two, I think to maintain the teamwork is very important. And Pak Jokowi is, you know, give target to any minister to achieve, and which is, I think, he challenged also the minister, if you cannot achieve this target by this time, then I'm going to replace you. Simple as that. And that's why if you look at now the minister within the country working very hard, yeah, some of them, yeah, performs so-so, but the economic team so far, I think, performs quite well. And strong law enforcement, I think that's one of the complaints from the foreign investor. I promise you that the government of, especially Pak Jokowi being businessman in background, he really wants to fix this issue. And for the next 2-3 years' time, maybe 2 years' time, then I think our economy is still a little bit flat, not growing like very much. But after 2 years' time, I believe our economy can move very quick. I'm strong belief that we can go to 7%, even maybe above 7% by the year 2018. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for this presentation. I'm ready to answer any question raised by all of you. Thank you very much.
I can stay here. You can stay over there. What do you prefer? Whatever you want. I want to be here.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So we'll open up the floor. If you have a question, Lynn, please. Please identify yourself and.
Thank you very much. My name is Lynn Kwok, and I'm from Brookings Institution. I had a question on the South China Sea. There is talk about differing approaches within Indonesia about how to approach China's encroachments into the waters off the Natuna Islands. On the one hand, you have the foreign ministry's approach, which is to downplay these developments and to seek to play the role of an honest broker between ASEAN and China. On the other hand, there's also talk of the military wanting to take a stronger approach against China. Could you speak a little bit about these two supposed, you know, conflicting approaches within Indonesia, especially in light of talk that President Jokowi is actually more focused on economic performance within the country, so that foreign policy will very much be left to his advisers?
Well, let me put like this. Sorry, my ear not so good, maybe because of Bob Gilbert, ambassador, you know. I was trained in the military so many, you know, sometimes I have problem with my ear. Sorry, forgive me about this. I think the discussion between President Jokowi and Senator John McCain at the time is very clear, you know. We're not going to use any military force in this area. What we're going to promote is a dialogue. Any issue, dispute issue, we're going to promote dialogue solution. And we believe that's, I think, the best solution. So in the dispute, the South China Sea, that's, I think, we can do with the dialogue. Indonesia can be also, you know, bridging this, you know, this this dispute, you know, between China and Philippines and China with Vietnam. So that's, I think, the best solution for this kind of issue. Regarding of the Natuna also, I we understand very much. This is the territory of Indonesia, and I don't think there are any problems so far. And we're going to do our exploration for the gas, Natuna gas, and I think with the Chevron joint operation with the Pertamina. So again, we don't have any plan to use our armed forces to solve the dispute issue in this region. Yeah.
Other questions, comments? Please.
I'm going to lean over a bit. Excuse me, we're short of microphones at this end of the table. I'm Rana Freiberg with LSI Associates, consulting firm here in Washington. Thank you so much for your remarks. I'd like to refer to the point you made about education in Indonesia and its link to not only to economic development but to national security. Is the president, and I know the president has many, many priorities to deal with right now, but you seem to suggest that education is something that he's personally interested in. And if I'm not mistaken, Indonesia has been operating under a 20-year plan for education that was developed in 2005. Do you know whether the instruction to the Ministry of Education is to revise education policy? What are the targets that are being established?
Yes, thank you very much, ma'am. See, look at now the posture, the structure of our the cabinet of Jokowi. He transferred Director General of Higher Education to the Minister of Research. The reason to do so, again, to tackle about the quality of education, especially on the technology on the outside of Java. He dreams that we like to see the research university outside of Java. None today, per today. So only in Java Island. So in order to do so, I think the Minister of Research have to focus higher education and research in one ministry. So now you're going to link education, higher education, research, and industry in order to improve our industry. So if you look at now the downstream industry, for instance, it is very, very important. There are a lot of downstream industry outside of Java, while the quality of education over there very low. Now, if you have to export from Jakarta, from Java to outside of Java, this could also trigger some kind of unhappiness within the island, you know, because say, why should come from Java? Why don't you use our people? But when we're going to use them, the quality of the people over there, especially on technology, is very low. So now in order to avoid this kind of problem, we have to improve the quality of education, especially on technology over there. So I think that the policy not gonna change much, but the way they do it, I think they're different. So President Jokowi very concerned on this, and everybody understand this is one of the issue that we have to address. And I believe President Jokowi can tackle this issue. And within 5 years, we can see a lot of changing Indonesia. And he gave also quite a lot of fund, a budget to Minister of Education, Minister of Research, for instance. We don't want to be only market of high technology. We like to see Indonesia also to export high technology. Look at the population of Indonesia, 250 million. Assume only 0.5, very smart. There's 12.5 million people, largest than Singapore. If you educate them very well, then a lot of smart people from Indonesia. Now, during the visit of President, next visit of the President to Washington next July, he already planned. They're going to give a speech to maybe, I don't know, maybe Harvard, maybe MIT, whatever. What's the target? He's going to request, you give a slot to the smart people of Indonesia to do further study here, maybe for PhD, maybe postdoc. What the purpose of that? They're going back to Indonesia. They have to help the education, to help the industry, so many things. Because there are a lot of opportunity in Indonesia right now available. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Was there another hand? Please. Brian.
Thank you. Brian Harding from the Center for American Progress. I was wondering if you could offer your perspectives on among President Jokowi's priorities, which might he be able to accomplish through executive action, executive authority within the presidency, and which do you think he needs to work with the parliament on? And related to that, if the president is able to form a majority coalition sometime next year, are there any new areas of reform that you think the president might take on?
Reform? Well, first of all, I think cooperation and relation with the parliament going to be much better next year, and I believe so. I don't see much threat anymore, that's my personal view, anymore from the parliament toward the president, because they know the president very firm. Before, maybe they thought because he's very humble, then I can play with this man, you know, because he's from Solo, I'm from Jakarta, I'm a rich man, and so, but this one, this guy from, you know, from middle of nowhere, I can play with. Today, no. It never happened in the history of Indonesia, 87 people arrested in one time. This one, even one major general was arrested yesterday, and he doesn't care, the president. So he proved it. So again, your concern about the issue with the dynamic of the parliament, I don't think it's going to be a big issue anymore. Yeah, maybe I'm too optimistic on this, but no, being my assessment so far, I'm quite correct on that. So I'm very confident that I don't see that much problem in that. The other... you said the parliament, as I said, no problem with the parliament. Yeah, there are so many things can be done with the parliament because the spirit of this to bring economic growth and to bring equality for the people of Indonesia. So what's the parliament against with this? If you against Jokowi with this for this program, you against the people of Indonesia. As simple as that. So to be honest to you, I don't see much problem. Of course, yeah, he's facing internally, you know, because he make now very efficient, which is some of the people used to enjoy with this lucrative, corruption. Yeah, now less and less. Yeah, that's a problem maybe facing by Jokowi. You know, look at now also the corruption cases tackled by Jokowi. Maybe some of these people trying to play game. But again, I believe with the style of Jokowi, he can manage this one very well. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, could I just follow up on that question?
Yes.
You mentioned before we started this meeting that that President Jokowi thought he had to get going really fast with his program, mm-hmm. because he would, particularly if he wanted to be reelected in 2019. And what do you see as the political challenges he might face going forward beyond the possible tensions with Parliament? Who could be breathing down his neck ahead of 2019?
Yeah, I think his promise, he has to deliver his promise like 70, 80%. If not, the people say, hey, you are only talking, you know. Indonesia is very smart people now. Who is challenging him? I think so far till today, nobody. Yeah, I can tell you nobody can challenge him today, but today, yeah, because yeah, he still deliver what he promised. So again, depend on how much he deliver what he promised during his campaign. But if you look at now the, you know, I'm not saying statistically, but what he delivered so far, I think he's quite okay, you know. Yeah, some issue not yet addressed very well. Takes some time, only 40 days so far. So it's too early to judge. Yeah. Let's see after 3 months or 1 quarter, maybe then we can see, you know, the progress. Yeah.
Saw some other hands in the back. In the back there, please.
Thank you. My name's Michael, and I work with the Global Poverty Project. I'm just wondering that you mentioned a lot of the poverty issues which the president wanted to address. How much of an issue is lack of access to sanitation? And is it something that's high on the president's agenda? I know Prime Minister Modi of India, also elected this year, that was a big thing he made. He promised to provide sanitation for all toilets and households by 2019, I think. And I'm just wondering, in Indonesia, if that's an issue and if there's anything being addressed there.
Well, sorry to say, we are not so primitive, I think. Our sanitation is not a big issue in Indonesia anymore. We know how to handle this one. So the issue right now is poverty, yes, in general. Yeah, we are deal with this issue, and we're going to handle this very well. That's why I said, not only talking about growing our economy, but also we are talking about equality. Equality also, the people should enjoy also the fruit of this economic growth. So, yeah, the President Jokowi very concerned on the poor people. So, and he give his example by his own experience, because when during his childhood, he came from, you know, very poor family. So he said to me sometimes, Pak Luhut, I know how the feeling of the poor people, you know, because my family removed by the government 4 times in the Kali Solo, you know, in the Bengawan Solo River. You know, they moved from one place to another place to another 4 times. And so he said, I don't want to do this, you know. So he feel, I understand fully the feeling of the people. So then why they're not using the terminology of move the people, but he used the terminology of relocation of the people by providing them housing and something like that. So if you look at Jakarta, his experience in Jakarta, the Jakarta budget when he entered the office, it was 41 trillion rupiah, equivalent to $4 billion US dollar. But when he left his office in as a governor, it's like $7 billion US dollar. So within 1.5 years' time, he nearly doubled the budget of Jakarta. And by next year, the budget of Jakarta is going to be $10 billion US dollar. So I can understand why. And he says, simple, Pak Luhut, make it a government. So then all link with the IT, then you can manage and monitor everything. The taxpayer in Jakarta also increasing significantly. And I believe also within the country, Indonesia, you can see the difference within 2 years' time, 3 years' time. Let's say 3 years' time. So then I think Indonesia will be see the changing quite a lot. You know. So then I think give also some confidence to the people of Indonesia that Indonesia could enter the new era of Indonesia. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Pak Luhut. I'm Vikram Nehru from the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Yeah. Thank you very much for your remarks. I have a two-part question. The first is, I think everybody was very impressed by the increase in the oil price, the fuel price, which President Jokowi introduced pretty quickly into his term. And it came at a point when world prices were very low, so it was a very opportune moment to do so. But I think I was a bit puzzled as to why the president didn't use the opportunity to link the domestic price to the world price so that you could fix the subsidy and not the price. And this was a very good time to have done so. And I was wondering why you decided against that. But I know it was being discussed, but why did you decide against it? The second question is to do with infrastructure, the savings for infrastructure. And apart from the increase in the oil price, I wanted to ask you, what is this administration going to do differently from the past administration to accelerate infrastructure development? It's not as if previous administrations hadn't tried to increase infrastructure investment. So what are you going to do that's different? Thank you.
Yeah, number one, okay. This one, by law, we are not allowed to do so. The Constitutional Court decided 2004, we are not allowed to do so. So what we're going to do, we're going to take average price 1 month. So then going to link to this one. So they're going to do that, but the way they do it is different. We cannot just link it to the market price, but we make it average price per month. Then we link to that one. Basically, it's the same. So then I think we can keep the subsidy around $4 billion for next to the poor, to ordinary people. So that's number one. Number two, you're talking about what's the difference for the infrastructure? I think it's simple. He control to the ground. Before, none. This one, he check it to the ground. He understand fully what's really going on the ground. I give you an example. Electricity, the simple one. He said, well, it takes like nearly 3 years, 2 years' time to get the purchase price agreement, to get the license for the electricity investment in Indonesia. Now he said, hey, you can do it within 6 months. Within 6 months, you get the purchase price agreement. Number two, for instance, he said, okay, how long does it take the payback of the investment? Okay, 8-9 years' time. So we have to ensure that this can be payback within 8 to 9 years' time. And then how much a project IRR? He said 14-15%. So something like this, you come up with how many cents per kilowatt hour. So then secure to the foreign direct investment, within 8 to 2 years' time, you get back your investment in Indonesia. Another issue like geothermal. Geothermal, we are the largest geothermal potential in the world. I think like 90,000 megawatt, including the hot water. The geothermal, pure geothermal is around 29,000 megawatt. Only 10% so far, using in Indonesia. Why? Because the price. So we discussed it with the president. I said, why don't we just give it 15-16%, but levelize. When they pay back done, you go to the normal price because no more energy cost on that because it's just your steam. So the president agreed. So right now we'll see the geothermal, they're very attractive to invest in Indonesia because, secure the investment going to be payback within 8 or 9 years' time. Before, they just set up, how many cents? 6 cents? 6 cents per kilowatt hour. We don't know how long does it take to get the payback. I think the IRR, project IRR maybe only 11%, which is very low. So this kind of project is make a difference with some other, compared to the, if I may say, previous government. Yeah, thank you, Pak.
Thank you. General, I'm Bill Wise, Johns Hopkins University School of Advanced International Studies. You mentioned the importance of strong armed forces, but you spoke specifically only about special forces. If you look at Indonesia's defense problem objectively, let us say, solely on military grounds and without political consideration, it looks like the current force mix, heavy on land forces and light on air and naval forces doesn't fit an archipelagic nation like yours. One would think you would want to invest more in airlift and sea lift, in ISR and in coastal defense to 200 nautical miles, things like that, stronger naval and air forces. Some might call that, in Indonesia's case, military reform. I wonder what, if anything, do you and your colleagues plan in the area of military reform? Question one. And the second question, with regard to reform, what message did the president intend to send by his appointment of his defense minister?
The last question first. No message, you know, but he's a military, pure military. He's a good guy. He was working under me before. I don't see any problem, and he proved it that he can, you know, work in line with the policy of the president. Yeah, he's very clear on that. So president said to me some time ago, he has to follow my, you know, my policy. Regarding of the special forces, I was brainwashed by the American special forces, so I talk a lot about special forces. No, I'm joking. No, I just give example. Basically, the government of Joko Widodo like to give more budget for the Navy because we like to see more, sea patrol in order to control our territory, our border, like in Arafura, in the northern part of Indonesia. Very little our vessel present over there. We like to see also maybe in like in Manado area, in what area, North Sulawesi, and we like to see maybe our fleet gonna be much bigger over there to control our border over there. So, yeah, Air Force I think very important also for Indonesia. We like to see also more C-130 present over there. Right now only 3 squadron. I believe we are going to have at least 5 squadron in order to, you know, manage our territory. I think you are all aware that distance from eastern from Sorong to Jakarta is like, you know, 4 hours flying time by jet, you know, by C-130 maybe nearly 5 to 6 hours flying time. So we consider that. So in the same time now we order, I think, Apache from U.S. And also we are talking also about drones. Drones very important, the program of Joko Widodo to manage our territory, border, our sovereignty. So basically we are dealing with this problem. We are not talking only specific to the special forces, but I'm talking about special forces because focus on the ISIS. ISIS issue, I think the role of special forces is very important. The Army Special Forces, the Navy Special Forces, gonna be work together with our intelligence agencies to tackle this issue. Yeah.
Oh, so many offers. Thank you. Well. First of all, my name is Andre Sauvageau, and I'm the director for Vietnam and Southeast Asia for the Interstate Traveler Company in Detroit, Michigan, and we make or have designed a high-speed magnetic levitation rail, which would be great for Indonesia, mm-hmm. by the way. Anyway, moving rapidly along. My question, sir, is a follow-on to, I think, the first question that was asked about the South China Sea. Mm-hmm. And I agree with you that Indonesia has a central position in ASEAN as a great dialogue partner. You've showed that after that conference in ASEAN meeting in Cambodia where they, you know, the Hun Sen wouldn't sign a resolution, a common resolution articulating, specifying China's violations of the exclusive economic zone. But my question is this. Certainly you're positioned to be a great dialogue partner, and you've already been one and you're doing it. But my question is, if China continues, as they still are, using violent intrusions in violation of the UN 1982 Convention on the Law of the Sea, which they signed, they ratified in 1996, and if they continue to use violence, then dialogue per se maybe needs some very special ingredients. So my question is this. What kind of combination of incentives for China plus pressures could, in your mind, sir, persuade Beijing that peaceful coexistence and adherence to international law is actually better for China, since after all, we all want good relations with China, but we don't want to give up our kemerdekaan, our independence. Well, I think China like also to maintain their cooperation and relation with the countries surrounding China. You know, ASEAN is you know, one of the potential partner of China. The 600 million population of ASEAN is not you know, small number. So I don't believe that China could create kind of you know, power game over there. I mean, using power to settle the dispute over there. I still believe that the dialogue is the best solution for this, to achieve win-win solution. Because I think at the end, talking about from economic perspective, because I think everybody understand that they discover quite huge energy reserve in that particular area, if you're talking about South China Sea. So again, the government of Indonesia, I think the Jokowi administration believe the dialogue is all the best solution on this particular issue. And we're not going to use any power to solve this problem. This is also against our constitution. But again, I believe the dialogue and personal relation between head of state, China, Indonesia, China with some other countries among the ASEAN could also give some support on this agenda. But in the same time, I think cooperation with U.S., Indonesia and ASEAN with the U.S., I think it's also very important at the same time. So now, if you look at also the cooperation between government Indonesia, Pertamina and Chevron to explore the what do you call it, gas in Natuna area, this is one of the target, give the signal to the China, okay, you cannot play it, you know, game here because there's also the presence of U.S., but at the same time, you also promote the dialogue with the China government, yeah.
We're almost out of time and we've got a bunch of hands up. Maybe what I'll do is if you can each ask a very quick question, starting here, and then there's two back there, but please keep your question short and then we'll have the Luhut answer all at once.
Thank you, General. Alex Brooks from the UK Embassy. Thanks for coming along today. Could you briefly set out President Jokowi and his foreign policy advisor's vision for ASEAN and how it will evolve, and perhaps also some of the fora on top of it, such as the East Asia Summit?
We'll ask three questions,
yes.
And then you can answer.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Please.
My name is Vibhan Shu. I'm from the American University. My question relates to China's recently floated Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. Indonesia did not initially join. So my question is, what were the reasons why Indonesia didn't join? But it did join later on. It didn't join with 9 ASEAN countries when they joined. So what changed? And so your reasons for why not joining and why joining now? Thank you.
Thank you so very much, sir, for... thank you. Very good. Okay. Can I be heard? Okay. Thank you so very much, sir, for honoring me to be asked to ask this question. My name is Rita Girona Adkins. I am a journalist. I write for U.S.-based Asian Pacific Americans, as well as also readers in the Philippines and other parts of Asia. I'm a journalist, a freelance journalist. Sir, President Jokowi's policies prioritizes, among other things, maritime concerns. And this, my question is that, considering that President Indonesia is in a very good position now to push the issues that also concerns other Asian Pacific countries, would you be able to address how Indonesia, through the President Jokowi's priorities, would be able to push the code of conduct, which is, of course, for maritime safety, which, of course, has connotations for trade, for maritime peaceful purposes, and it's important for the economies, not only for the Asian countries, but for the rest of the world. Sir, would you be able to address that as to how much clout would President Jokowi and his administration would be able to put to precisely put the code of conduct in effect?
The ASEAN, the Indonesian role in the future for the ASEAN, yeah? Yeah, the ASEAN, I think like I mentioned earlier, yeah, we like to see again the dialogue is very important. We're not going to think that we're going to, you know, present power to solve the problem. Power is the last solution for Indonesia.
and we'll try as much as possible. I think the dialogue is to promote dialogue to solve the problem. If you look at Indonesia, maybe 5, 10 years from now, maybe 15 years from now, I think our economy growth going to be much bigger than today. And at the same time, also going to be one of the maybe 5th or 7th largest economy on the earth. So this is also give good signal toward other countries that Indonesia not only the largest, fourth largest of population, but also at the same time also one of the economic largest in the world. Now, in the same time also, we're going to promote our armed forces, enhance our weapon system, and also to well train our own soldiers. So then I think Indonesia become of the strongest power in that region. So this is kind of also deterrent strategic for Indonesia, but in the same time we also like to play our bigger role in the future. But again, in the peaceful approach. Again, we don't want to hurt, to disturb, or to against our constitution. Constitution said very clear, loud and clear, all the foreign policy have to be dialogue solution. And number two, you are? Well, yes, very interesting question about the joint infrastructure bank. Yeah, I think it's a bank. Yeah, if that, I think finally, agreed by President Jokowi. And again, you know, because he believed, well, we need also the infrastructure fund. So this is a good opportunity for Indonesia. That's why he asked also the office of the infrastructure fund in Indonesia. Although we are a small equity contribution in that project, in this organization, but President Jokowi requested very much that this headquarters have to be in Jakarta. And I believe this is also part of his solution to solve the problem, because we need, like I mentioned in my slide before, $545 billion, not small fund. So we like also to the participation of this bank in this program. So again, this may be one of his dreams to make Indonesia become a very prosperous country in the years to come. Number the last one about code of conduct at sea. Yes, yeah, of course. The discipline. I believe the Pak Jokowi can be a good role model for our people at sea. So to promote. That's the way we do it. That's the way we behave. So, but we have to be firm that we have to protect any interest. Every country, interest of Indonesia, interest to other country. We respect that. But we have to respect also to our own sovereignty. Sovereignty in Indonesia cannot be negotiated. This is the way that we do it. So if you look at the before that, we have problem that we lost our island because of, you know, no control by the government of Indonesia. But today we're going to deploy our own forces in that island, in the outside of our border. So we don't want to deal with this kind of problem anymore. So we are very, very firm on this. But of course, again, with the dialogue, and also with the peaceful solution. So that's I think my answer.
Yeah. Luhut Panjaitan, thank you very much for sharing the wide-ranging overview of the priorities of the new president of Indonesia, President Jokowi. Wish you and him all the best. And please, everybody, join me in thanking Pak Luhut.
If I may say the closing statement on this beautiful gathering, I would like to thank you again to all of you. And I would like to, hope that you can support the government of the Jokowi administration, which is, I think, very important. He needs the support from all of you. And I can, I promise you that he is very eager to see Indonesia better than today. And when I met him before I came here last week, he asked me also to convey his message to all of you that he would like to be a good leader in Indonesia, we like to bring prosperity to the people of Indonesia, we like also to enhance the relationship between Indonesia and U.S., and we like to see to visit the U.S. very soon, and we like also to see more U.S. Investor to invest in Indonesia. So again, thank you very much, and from the bottom of my heart, I like to thank you to the CSS institution and to invite me to give the speech here and also to present the program of my government. Thank you very much.